Hello, malty, marvellous malt monsters. And thank you to Saltire for that malt mention. This is Ralfy Review 712 Extras. And in 712, the video, the vlog, the malt marked review before this extras review, I gave 82 out of 100 to 12-year-old Glenfiddich single malt whiskey. Now, that doesn't seem a particularly high mark by Ralfy's standards, and you're right, it isn't. But it is still over 80 out of 100. This is certainly a malt that I am happy to buy and to Ralfy recommend. And it's got quite a backstory to it. And here in Ralfy Review 712 Extras, I'm going into a little more depth into the history, the personality, and the provenance of Glenfiddich, the brand. Right. Won't be a minute. Prohibition was in the 1920s. It was brought about to ban the consumption, the sale, the enjoyment of alcoholic beverages. And any politician or decision maker with an ounce of common sense would realise it's not going to work. But do you know what, malt mates? Common sense goes out the window when the money is slapped down on the table and decisions are bought. And it was the petrochemical companies, Standard Oil, who bought the prohibition movement, who financed the temperance campaign. Sure, the abuse of alcohol was serious. And in many communities around the world, the abuse of alcohol still is. Although I do notice there is now a new generation of responsibility, as if through social education across borders, and it's quite global now, people are realising the damage of drug abuse in all its forms, and how inevitably to enjoy any quality of life, we have to take responsibility and discipline ourselves in our exposure to all the drugs we are exposed to. And I'm not talking just about tobacco and cannabis and alcohol. I'm talking about prescription medications as well. We all have to do careful research. And do you know what's far better than cure from any addiction? Prevention. Interestingly, when here in January 2018, there is a growing movement of Dry January, which has been brought about partly due to the success of Movember, Mustache November, in which men have been empowered to raise money for prostate cancer awareness and men's health issues through growing and shaving mustaches. And even some of the ladies have joined in, which is all very accommodating and good. And but the things don't stand still. And in an age of change, change has never been so changeable and rapidly changing as it is now. Very interesting times for the humanoid collective. And what we're seeing is a growing awareness as to the social irresponsibility and the increasing social intolerance of visible alcohol abuse in public. And I think that is a very good thing, that people generally who value their reputations in the age of instant social media, where the slightest lapse of concentration and sobriety due to being intoxicated can lead to someone ripping out their mobile phone, getting an embarrassing picture and posting it on Instagram. Just sharing, it happens. That is why it's so important for all of us who engage with social media that we are careful to manage our own avatar. the version of ourselves that we put online. And also it applies to whiskey brands, like people, everything. And in that sense, Glenfiddich holds itself in quite good account in its presence online. The image is really quite a traditional one for a single malt, but its visibility amongst the growing cavalcade of options when it comes to whiskey is actually holding really well. Partly because of the design of the bottle. This is the triangle bottle. You see it when I hold the base up, you see. That's when you really see it. You'll find this bottle in over 180 countries around the world. It's one of the most geographically, diversely available single malts in the world. Some of the countries you wouldn't think would even stock single malt whiskey seem to have a bottle of Glenfiddich. Good stuff. And as such, where you find it, it tends to be an affordable malt. And I think this is all credit to the long-term strategy and vision of William Grant, the family owners of the Glenfiddich brand, along with Balvenie and Kininvie and Girvan and Aylesabay, that they really have been ahead of the game for quite a while in the innovation and presentation of single malt whiskies. They don't seem to make the same consistent slip-ups that less dedicated large companies can make. Let's go into this in a bit more detail. Let's start with the triangular bottle. It used to have sharper edges, by the way, back in the 1970s. They've rounded off the triangular shape of the bottle. The reason being, like square bottles, when you've got edges in bottles, it makes the bottles more vulnerable to breaking if they are dropped or tipped over. So that you now have this morphing of the brand, the visible bottle brand, into something which is more practical. And I really don't see how they can change it much further. In a green bottle, of course, because they are not adding much in the way of caramel colourant to their single malt. Well, certainly the 12-year-old, and I do commend Glenfiddich for that. It's a fairly standard presentation, quite an understated, mute, demure label. But back in the 1970s, after Prohibition, let's go back to Prohibition, because during Prohibition, whiskey was still available. The rum runners were doing their work, and it wasn't just rum they were running, it was whiskey as well. And it failed. But it failed just in time to get the alcohol industry to stop producing alcohol-fueled engines, so that oil derivative fuels could dominate the internal combustion engine. Bear in mind that Henry Ford, when he created his Model T, any colour so long as it's black, that one, he sold it with two engine options, alcohol or petrol. The petrol engine was weaker, it was more complicated, and it was more prone to breaking down. The alcohol engine was better, stronger, the fuel was cheaper. It was more efficient. It was less polluting. And that is why Prohibition was financed as a commercial political maneuver and had nothing to do with people's health. Okay, okay, just sharing. Go read your history books. Forget mainstream media and what they're telling you. Forget what you were taught in schools. Go and read the original source material history books and see how different history is, maltmates. How different it is to what you are being told. It is the past which defines the present, and the present dictates the future. Understand that. All helps with a glass of whiskey. There's quite a variety of Glenfiddichs out there, and a remarkable diversity of flavours within the range. Generally, they are kind of affordable, not the 50 or the 40-year-old. Anything with a seriously high age statement is funny money now, so take what I'm saying in context. But after Prohibition, this is when Glenfiddich really found its feet as a single malt, because due to careful business planning, which wasn't the norm in those days, the Grant family, who were canny business folk, it's as simple as that, they had prepared the re-emergence of the alcohol market in the USA well in advance and had stocks of whiskey ready to go into the US after Prohibition was lifted. And as such, they hit the ground running. People would go into a bar, anywhere, they'd see the Glenfiddich up in the shelf. It wasn't gaudy, it was flashy, it wasn't flashy, it was demure, it was kind of classy, it was sort of well-heeled sort of brand. And it was up, sitting up in the higher shelf. And there's a reason for that. The higher up, the nearer it is to heaven. Ask a barman, ask a barista, they'll tell you. Positioning in bar shelves is so important. Below eye level, above eye level. Psychology. And it was really by the 1970s, because Glenfiddich engineered the whole single malt category. Sure, you could buy Macallans, Ardbegs, you could buy Highland Parks in the 1920s and 30s and 40s. They did exist, but they were very much a small niche specialist market, which is why so few of these bottles are around today and why so many of them are fakes. It's the money. Always follow the money. But in the 1970s, Glenfiddich did something that hadn't been done before. Just at the downturn, heading towards the 1980s, when you had the whiskey loch filling up of surplus whiskey, and distilleries were closing down left, right and centre due to lack of demand. Yes, it's not that long ago, and it may well happen again, because everything is cyclical. Distillers, take note. It was Glenfiddich who were the first to open the visitor centre at the distillery. Now you think about it, malt mates. A factory, that's what a distillery is. It is a liquor factory, like a shoe factory, like an electronics factory, like an abattoir, like a market garden. It's a factory for the production of a commodity. But Glenfiddich took the chance. I mean, they just looked at what they had, the shiny stills, the lovely smells, and they created the visitor centre experience. And from the very start, it was very successful. And since then, virtually every other single malt distillery around the world has followed in Glenfiddich's footsteps. It's Glenfiddich who first introduced these. The carton, the tin, the presentation box, the classy cardboard metal top, triangle shaped to match the bottle, all beautifully coordinated and not too expensive. This really hadn't happened before, and it's interesting to note that when you see these pre-war whiskies from the 1920s, 30s, 40s and 50s, they often have a screw top, the plainest of labels, the most functional of simple bottles, and absolutely no presentation whatsoever. That is not, it's not by design, it's completely by default. It's Glenfiddich who upped the game for single malts with better quality packaging, and did so in order to introduce their whiskey successfully into a new style of duty-free liquor shops to be found at airports, in the days when airports genuinely sold liquor without duty being paid. Nowadays, don't be under any illusion, duty is paid, because governments will always want money, even when they don't need it. They'll still want money, and they'll always take it from the weakest options they can, and that is from the general public, who don't have the power to resist. Fact of life. But it's Glenfiddich who really featured most prominently in the tourism and holiday boom that followed the Second World War in the 1960s, as the coastal towns and seaside resorts of dear old Blighty, that lovable, toxic little country in the... It's true. There's not just cool Britannia, there's cruel Britannia, and let's all be fully aware of that. As people travelled, as more and more people flew in aeroplanes and went through ports and went on cruises, it's the duty-free became available, and an awful lot of whiskey was sold in duty-free, and Glenfiddich, again, were right in there from the beginning, getting it right. What are they going to do next? I don't know. They're having an experimental stage with X's and IPAs and all the rest of it. They've had their blend, the William Grant blend, matured in X-ale casks, and frankly, it hasn't particularly worked, in my opinion. Just an opinion. But I do think that Glenfiddich still have the ability to pull the bunny rabbit out the top hat, to perform another magician's trick of redefining the brand at this moment in time, as it's starting to not go stale, but there's just too many distilleries doing the same thing. And really, the time is coming near where something dramatic, exciting, innovative, truly innovative, not marketing, not unique, but seriously, properly innovating, is going to take place. Interesting times we're living in, single malt mates. Yes, and blend mates too. I'm Ralfy. Anything else I want to say about Glenfiddich the brand, just in my little extras and Ralfy ramblings? Well, not a lot, really. I'm going to come back to something I mentioned in the previous review, which is Ailsa Bay. You may not have heard of this single malt. It only appeared in the market in Britain a couple of years ago. I was given a glass to sample and asked my opinion in a bar somewhere in Scotland, because I think the proprietors were kind of curious as to the fact that Ailsa Bay is unusual as a Scotch single malt whiskey. It's bottled at 48.9%, and it's a lowland whiskey which is peated. Now, interesting stuff that, because there really is very little objective comparison you can make with any other lowland single malts, because generally they're not peated. You do have peated Bladnachs, the 8, 9, 10 year old peated Bladnachs from the Armstrong era of Bladnach are very interesting and worthwhile looking out if you can find one. But certainly Glenkinchie don't do peated whiskey. Auchentoshan don't do peated whiskey, partly because they're triple distilled. You don't see peated whiskey from Daft Mill. Don't see anything from Daft Mill yet, but maybe soon. But generally, lowland single malts are invisible for peated versions until Ailsa Bay. In my opinion, you will find it a very interesting, worthwhile, thought-provoking malt to source, and you can buy it online from whiskey shops in the UK. Enough said. Just telling you a bit about it. I'm Ralfy. I'm finished here. I'm all done. I have completed my little malt moment. A re-review of Glenfiddich 12-year-old, a rather iconic version of a Scotch single malt whiskey. And I shall finish this glass off. And when I do so, just as a final parting shot, malt mates, I shall probably add a little drop of another single malt whiskey into this glass. Because one of the wonderful characteristics of 12-year-old Glenfiddich specifically is that it is a perfect chameleon malt for carrying the flavours, infusing and producing beautiful blends when you add a drop of other single malt whiskies. Go try it, malt mates. There's only one way to find out, and that's to do it yourself. I'm Ralphie. I'm all finished. I wish you well. I'll see you soon. Goodbye.